Let me also welcome Aditi Nair, principal economist at ICRA, who's joining us as well. Aditi, thank you for joining us on Mirror Now. Your first assessment of the budget, because obviously all the headline numbers really sound good, but what, according to you, really stood out today?
Thanks, Avni. You know, today's budget has been presented under unprecedentedly high expectations. And I must say that the budget was able to deliver a whole lot in a fairly short speech. So we've got lots of, good news in terms of the proposals that have been made, and especially in terms of the increased allocations that we've got for the health sector and for the infrastructure sector, which is absolutely what we were looking forward to and what we were hoping we were going to get in today's budget. Now, moving on to the revenue side, I must say that the assumptions that have been made for the non-tax revenues and for the tax revenues seem to be extremely credible, because they're pretty much in line with the nominal GDP growth of 14 to 15% that we're expecting in FY22. And therefore, that part of the budgetary math seems to be extremely credible. But we do have the fiscal deficit both for the current year and for the next year, which is much higher than what we had projected. And that's because we've got this significant augmentation in the allocation which is being made for food subsidies. So that has come as a little bit of a surprise, only in terms of the size of what has now been included on budget. Although it's, of course, increasing the transparency of the budget number, so it's very much welcome. But because this is somewhat unexpected in terms of the size of the increase, both for FY21 and for FY22, therefore the headline fiscal deficit numbers have come in much higher than what we had projected for both of these years.
Right. Aditi, just on that point of the non-tax revenue that you were talking about, the divestments, disinvestments plan that the government has put out, the target is less than last year, but at the same time, we're talking about, privatizing two banks, one general insurance company, we're talking about the IPO of LIC. Somewhere, do you not feel that is slightly, the disinvestment target could perhaps be more than that, the final numbers could be more than the target?
So let me clarify, when I said non-tax revenues, I meant the revenue receipts from the non-tax side. Hmm. What you were talking about is the disinvestment inflows which are included in the miscellaneous capital receipts.
Right.
So over there, we thought the government may put in a number of around 1.5 trillion for the coming year. What they put in is 1.75 trillion. It's lower than the budgeted target for this year, but it is still a huge number. And there is a healthy pipeline. Now we need to see how the market conditions are, what is the interest from the investors, etc. Because ultimately that's going to determine whether the planned transactions can actually close in the coming year. They may close later, but that's still going to end up leading to a slip in terms of the target that's been budgeted for FY22. So it's always a little difficult to say upfront whether the disinvestment target is going to be challenging or if it's actually going to turn out to be an underestimate. At this point in time, I think let's just hope that it starts quickly, that the ball gets rolling quickly on the disinvestments, so that the target can actually be met to a large extent. And therefore, we don't end up in a situation where either there have to be capex cuts at the end of the year, or that the fiscal deficit ends up being even higher than what has been budgeted for FY20.
Right. That part, that's an important point, that this is, of course, two banks, one general insurance company, the LIC IPO, all of this is extremely aggressive and bold, so to speak. But whether it's really going to pan out in the time frame is the big question.
Yes, it is. I mean, look, Aditi mentioned about, the Brexit number being a little more than what they had anticipated. Look, we are journalists, so we have a little more liberty of saying that actually we thought it would be much more. In fact, it's great that they've actually been transparent with the numbers, and I think that's a very welcome thing, because that helps put everything in perspective properly. And actually, I would have expected that they have now brought it down to a more realistic level. I think 2.1 lakh crore was a very unrealistic figure. And of course, even if there was no pandemic, it was really a very unrealistic figure. Even now, the big challenge that I see, and that's a big challenge for Sudhanshu and his government, which is this: when you start talking about privatization of two PSU banks, you will run into labor issues for sure. The unions of the banks are very, very organized, and they can be very aggressive as a group, and it's going to be a bit of a tightrope walk for the government, because you really cannot antagonize a large section of the employee base there. Even LIC IPO, for instance, I mean, that again is a bit of a challenge. One thing which I got very excited by, but then my excitement got a little tempered, was the government announced the asset monetization program. Now, that is something that people have been talking about for a long time. The one thing that struck me surprisingly is they haven't put any target to it. There is no number that has been given to it. It's a great idea. I mean, the government sits on great assets and the railway sits on magnificent assets. The roads and highways leasing can be a huge source of opportunity, but I don't know, the government seems to have for some reason not given how much they expect to raise by that kind of leasing or monetizing of those assets. But for me, even the disinvestment issue is an implementation target, because see what's happening with Air India. I mean, last 10 years or so, we've been trying to do that, and for a variety of reasons, whether it is the whole issue of who's going to take up the liabilities or whether it's just a union issue, the issue has been dragging on, and it continues to drag on. So it's a challenge, and I'm hoping that, you know, the one thing that I'm really hoping, and Sudhanshu, I'm sure, will agree with me on this, that the one advantage of having political capital with you, when you come back to, you know, in government with 303 seats, you have the political might and the political capital behind you. And this is the right time to actually use that political capital and then see that these things go through. Because this is not the time to get blackmailed. Because unions will inevitably create an issue. Yes. There's no doubt about that. But I guess if this is the time, this is the year when we should do it without worrying about the impact of it, because we have no other option but to get this done if we really want the economy to stay afloat.
Yes, absolutely. And Sudhanshu, coming to you on just taking that point forward, how much of a challenge do you really see in the points that Vinay was really talking about? Because like we know what's been happening with Air India, and here at the same time we still don't know which are the two banks and the insurance company here. They haven't been named yet. Have they already been locked in?
See, taking up the challenge of disinvesting two banks and disinvesting insurance company is a political risk which the government has decided to take for the sake of the country. You know, these are important reforms. Government is been in business in a lot of areas where it should not be. This disinvestment of a bank is an antithesis of the bank nationalization which this country had seen and which had been propounded all this while as a socialist economic theory for the development of this country, which we have now discarded, why the world over is discarded. So now to take up that as an administrative reform, as a financial reform, as a structural reform, requires a great deal of courage, which governments have been talking but have shied away from attempting. I must congratulate the Prime Minister for this boldness which he has demonstrated to take up this challenge. And a very determined mind is always willing to take the political risk. And I mean, he should be applauded for that.
Sudhanshu, I'm really sorry. I just had a follow-up because you said something very significant. I don't know if you realize how significant a statement you've made. Are you saying that the policy of nationalized banks is now seeing a reversal? Because that's a big statement to make.
You see, the moment you are disinvesting in two banks, you are not acknowledging that the banking sector must be the exclusive domain of the government.
That it wasn't. You have saying, a private sector bank system, private coefficient.
Allow me to. See, in comparison to the some of the banks which have been performing in the private sector, some of the government banks have really underperformed and they have become liability instead of accomplishing the objectives for which they were there. And to take a bold decision of disinvesting in those banks is something which is a course correction. That banks which are not performing in the name of socialism, would you persist with them, is something which the government has clarified its intent. And to me, I think that intent needs to be welcomed. You know, status quo is very simple, very easy. To break the status quo and to move forward, looking at various considerations, and let me tell you, when a decision of this kind is taken, it is not just one consideration which is paramount. There are multiple reasons why a decision of this kind is taken, but what is critical is a decision of this kind. To say a bank which I owned, I am willing to disinvest in, it's a monumental decision which the government has taken, and I must compliment the government for that.
I wanted Aditi's view on this for the simple reason that what Sudhanshu is saying is very interesting, but it also is counterintuitive to one other fact. You know, for a country of the size of the economy that we are, one of our banks or at least two of our banks should ideally be in the top 50, top 100 banks of the world. Ideally, that's how it should be. We are not there. In fact, one of the strengths that India has, in my opinion, is that we have a very robust PSU bank system, especially for the large banks. I'm not talking about the smaller banks, of course. And I would suspect that one of the reasons why some of the PSU banks are distressed is NPS. It's not so much about, the size or anything else. It's really NPS. And PSU banks end up giving away loans where they have a difficulty in recovering it for a variety of reasons.
Yes.
That's where the real or the bigger problem is. But I would suspect that a bank of the size of the SBI or, some of the other big international banks are actually a huge asset for India. And the kind of the trust factor that the Indians have in the PSU banks, mind you, in the smaller towns is still higher than the private banks. I mean, a lot of India still has a perceptionally higher trust element with the government bank because they tend to believe this is not going to go down.
Yeah.
No matter what, the government won't allow it. It's just too big to go down, right? So
yeah.
There is a trust factor. So I don't know what the experts think on it, but that's the way I see it, that I see PSU's structure as a very strong aspect about the Indian banking systems.
Yes. Aditi, your view on this entire aspect, because obviously we know how much PSU banks especially have been struggling with NPAs. Once again, the budget did try to address that entire issue today as well, and we'll talk about that in a bit. But overall, to Vinay's point.
Let me address the second point first. I think the amount of money that has been provided for the bank equity capitalization seems to be a fair amount upfront. And, in case the situation turns out to be different, if the NPAs turn out to be higher than what is being expected right now, maybe there will be a need for an augmentation later on. But on the face of it, I think the amount of money which is being provided for the recapitalization seems to be quite fair. On the second point, I don't see it as such a sort of black and white issue. I don't think it's so binary. I think it's one step in terms of a host of different types of reforms that are being implemented in the banking space. So we've seen bank consolidation being done toward that point that you just mentioned, that we need to get to a larger scale and have the efficiency of scale which is there for the Indian banking system. And I am fairly certain nobody is trying to do away with public sector banks. I think this is one step that is being taken, and let's wait and see which banks are actually identified and to what level is the divestment done. So I don't think it's quite as binary, and I don't think that the public sector banks are going anywhere.
Okay. All right. On that note, what we'll do is we'll slip into another quick break and come back with more. Those were a whole host of reactions that have been coming in as far as the budget is concerned. But Mr. Kumar Mangalam, if I can come to you, my apologies. I believe you were trying to come in on the topic that we were just talking about before the break with respect to the government's disinvestment plan.
Well, I was wanting to talk about the bank nationalization piece. Of course, Mr. Tiwari sort of snatched that opportunity away from me as Mr. Sudhanshu Mittal disparaged bank nationalization as a whole, making it sound like BJP going to go do away with PSU banks completely. I want to point out a couple of things. If he'd ever been to a small town and tried to get an education loan or tried to get a farmer loan, he would have to end up going to a PSU bank. I haven't been to a single private bank in any small town that actually gives those loans out. Most of the private banks today only specialize in car loans, home loans, and credit cards. That's pretty much the bulk of their operations. Even if you look at MSMEs, you have to have at least 3 to 4 years of a record before you can walk into a private bank and get even working capital. So Mr. Mittal needs to be informed on the importance of actually bank nationalization and the very pivotal role that PSU banks play in our economy. The other thing I wanted to point out was, which has not been mentioned anywhere in the show so far, is that the allocation to MNREGA was 1.1 lakh crores last year and has been reduced to 70,000 crores. It's something that nobody is talking about. And the reason I bring that up is that it is a symptom, or rather, I would say, a shining symbol of this budget, wherein absolutely nothing has been done in terms of demand stimulation, direct demand stimulation. There is absolutely no reduction in consumption tax or direct tax. In fact, the increase in consumption tax by way of the agri-infra cess is regressive. So I don't see anything in this budget so far that is going to lead to immediate demand stimulation, which is what this economy has been begging for even before COVID. And we've been shouting from the rooftops, much to no avail.
All right. Yes, Mr. Mittal, I saw your hand up. Please go ahead.
Two things. Bank nationalization and public sector banks only is one thing, and having the ecosystem where both are there is another thing. When I referred to the bank nationalization, I was talking about the socialist mindset. We said only public sector banks. Today, to disinvest a bank which you have, which is not performing the function it was meant for, is a very, very bold decision. I hope you will understand the distinction between the two. Now, let me come down to a more substantive this thing. You just showed us the clips of the statement of Mr. Chidambaram and Mr. Shashi Tharoor. Mr. Chidambaram was so vociferously condemning the government about the healthcare as we have done nothing in that. And I had Mr. Shashi Tharoor complimenting the government and saying, yes, you have bitten the bullet, you've taken that, and you've done something for the healthcare, but this should have happened. So I think the Congress is a set of confused leaders who do not know what to say, because the budget comprehensively is so good that they are trying to figure out what they should be saying without actually knowing what they should be saying. Because if Mr. Shashi Tharoor is contradicting Mr. Chidambaram, then I think the Congress has to think who's a better economist or who's a better intellectual. Is it a Shashi Tharoor or a Chidambaram? You figure it out yourself. But to us, the criticism is sour grapes. It's not valid criticism. It is criticism because of the sake of criticism. Lastly, what is critical? As I have again explained about healthcare, a cess is a resource which generates phenomenal financial leverage for developing of this infrastructure. Let's understand this. This has not been debated, which I want that this debate should be there. The implication of the cess should never be viewed in terms of the immediate cess which will get collected in 1 year, but the kind of financial leverage it gives you to develop through other financing mechanisms, the health infrastructure is phenomenal. I have seen those benefits in other sectors, and I'm glad, like the benefits it gave in the road infrastructure sector. I'm glad that this says it's a long way in establishing the robust healthcare system the country needs.
All right. I'm afraid we're completely out of time. I'd like to thank all my guests for joining in on this discussion. Of course, there's still a lot more to talk about. But don't go anywhere. On the other side, we've got Tanvi Shukla, who will be having a conversation with...